I'm from Lahore. I went to the same school as Asma. Asma was a few years senior to me, but she was also a family friend. She was a very close friend of my brother-in-law, Najib Sethi, and my sister, Jubilee Mohsin. And I have had the great pleasure and the honor of of knowing Asma for many, many years. Not as closely as they did, but still of spending a great deal of time with her. And a lot has been said about her courage, and all of it is well deserved. And the fact that she, you know, her she packed so much into her life, it could have fitted into several lifetimes. It was a life well lived, and she struggled all her life as well. Things were not easy, but she fought on and on. And as she said in an interview to the BBC, that people think, I don't have fear. I do. There are times when I've been very afraid. There have been times when I've cried. But does that mean that I stop struggling? No, never. So when we talk about her courage, it's not as if, you know, it was some kind of genetic mutation that she had, that there was something missing in her. She did feel fear, but she put it all aside. Because for her, it was more important to give voice to the voiceless, to fight for the rights of people who didn't have any rights. But more than that, I want to celebrate her sense of humor. Her family will know that she had a wonderful sense of humor. She used to use Urdu phrases and Punjabi phrases to great effect. She had a fantastic radar for the pompous, for the hypocritical, for the sanctimonious and self-righteous. And she used her razor-sharp wit to deflate them. And I loved just listening to her. And the words, some of the words that she used were quite, I don't really use the word dated, but they were sort of old words, but she brought them to life and she gave them new life. So when they were talking about, once they were talking about the Fojis, and she said, by the way, Asma was not alone in voicing, in calling out injustice. There were other human rights activists, politicians, and journalists in Pakistan, but they were more cautious than Asma was, always more cautious. And on television, they would voice their concerns obliquely. So they would say things like, the powers that be, or establishment or the deep state. And Asma one day came on television and said, ye jo sare duffer hai, duffer hai ye sare to duffer hai, unko jana chahiye udhar apne barracks mein, wahi jaake rehna chahiye, jaan chhode hamari. Only she could get away with saying that. And the word duffer, I hadn't heard it since my government days, but enough just to say to us, you are a duffer child, you won't stand in the corner. I just loved that. And also, when Imran Khan first arrived on the scene in the very early days and started talking about clean government and always boasting about his achievements and and people were really taken in by him, but not Asma. And I remember we were talking, somebody said at dinner time, you know, usko bhi chance dena chahiye. Ab dekho, sabko try kar liya, usko bhi try karna chahiye. And Asma turned around and said, ek baat main tumhe bata dun, tumhe shayad nazar aaye chahe na aaye, aur uske pet ke andar daadi. This was before he gave those crores and crores and crores to Maulana Sarwar Haq. And this is before he was nominated by the Taliban as their spokesperson. But Asma spotted it very early, very, very early. And she knew exactly what he was about. And also, when General Musharraf arrived in our lives with two dogs under his arms, and I remember the liberals even were taken in by it. And they all said, you know, great, he's a liberal. So she turned around and said, do kutte paal liye to liberal ban gaye. Uski maa saadi pehen ke daash khel leti hai to liberal ban gaya. Usse dictator dictator, Hamesha dictator hota hai, yaad rakhna. And she was right. She was absolutely right. And you know, she wasn't taken in by that mantra of enlightened moderation. And she said, ye kahenge kuch, ab karenge kuch, yaad rakhna. And again, you know, she was spot on. You know, Asma had a very stressful life. Her life was constantly under threat. She was the target of a lot of hate. On social media, I've seen it. They didn't spare her. They didn't spare her daughters. She was always being threatened with violence. It was really ugly. The way she used to deal with the stress was that she would meet up with her old friends. And she had a band of really close friends. And she would hang out with them and she would chat to them. The night before she died, she called up two of her very old friends, Naji and Seema. And she was with them till 2:30 in the morning. And they cooked a fondue and they sat up till 2:30 smoking and chatting and gossiping and laughing. And I called up Seema after she passed away because Seema was very close to her. Now Seema Iftikhar was the daughter of the late great Mia Iftikharuddin, the Pakistan Times. And where Asma was public and Asma was cooperative and Asma was outspoken, Seema was private and Seema was very successful in her own field, but Seema was stylish and beautiful house, and Asma didn't really care about things like that. And so one day I said to Seema and Asma, I said, you know, it's always struck me as very strange that two of you are so thick, because you're so different, both of you. And I said, how did you become friends? So Asma said, you know, we were both at the convent, and iska baap bhi jail mein tha, mera baap bhi jail mein tha. And saari kehte the, humko saari ladkiye kehti thi, humko zaroor koi chori ki hogi hamare paas. Iska ko bhi jail mein dhar dete. So they would even talk to us, and you know, we were sort of completely your pariahs to the side. So chalo hum ek dusre se hi baat kar lete hain, humse koi baat hi nahi karta. And that's how we became friends. And then they began, you know, our fathers who aren't in jail. Anyway, so she was, when I called her up, I spoke to Seema and I said, Seema, I'm really, really, really sorry because I know what she meant to you. And she said, no, you don't know what she meant to you. And she said to me, she was not just a friend, she was my sister. She was my protector, and she was all our protector. All of us, she was our protector. Anyway, she said, you know, if I was to mention anything about Asma, yeah, her courage is very well known and everything, but to me, she was the most fiercely loyal friend. Her loyalty was extraordinary. She was a truly, truly fiercely loyal person. And, you know, Vajisa referred to the fact that even after her death, she was not spared in some places. Her loyalty was questioned again. And, you know, her faith was questioned. And her patriotism was questioned. Through her life, it was questioned. And after her life, it was questioned as well. And a lot of people said that she was in it for the thrill and that she enjoyed the spotlight. Well, you know, I know that Asma came from a well-to-do background and she had a comfortable life. And it wasn't easy being Asma. And I believe that what motivated her was a really, really deep aversion to injustice. And wherever she saw injustice, she had to fight injustice. It was just something which was part of her. It was intrinsic to her. A lot of people have said that in these few days that I've read lots of obituaries of her and talks and things I've heard on YouTube and things, and that her father was a great example in her life, and that he was her role model. And I'm sure that was true as well. But there's some things which are innate in people. And I think in Asma's case, the quest for justice was innate in her, and it was something that she could not stop for. You know, that she had to fight for justice. She had to give voice to the voiceless. And I believe that wherever she was, whichever time she'd been born in, and wherever she'd been born, she would have fought that fight. She would have fought that good fight. It was her great good fortune that she was born in Pakistan, that she lived in Pakistan, that she continued to stay in Pakistan despite everything that was thrown her way, and that she fought in Pakistan. And I think she was the greatest warrior that we've had in at least my memory. And lastly, I have to share two little things with you before I finish. That we were talking about her humor. So I've taken my children to Pakistan, and I'm sorry this is going to be a bit in Punjabi, and apologies to those who don't understand it, but I really can't translate this. If any of you can do it, that'd be wonderful. But so I'd taken my children to Pakistan, and they were with their nankas, and they were being thoroughly spoiled. And I had dinner with Asma, and she said, "Toh bache tere enjoy kar rahe?" So I said, "Asma, zara zyada hi enjoy kar rahe." She said, "Kyun?" I said, itne chaur ho gaye, pata nahi ghar jaake kya hoga inke saath andar." So she said, "Chaur ho gaye, chichad na ho bas." I remember she was at an interview, and there was this very senior journalist, and they said, "Could you shed light, please, on the army's involvement in the army's could you shed some light on the army's involvement in industry in your country, and the fact that the army controls a huge portfolio of industrial interests, etc." So Asma turned around and said, Yes, they do. In fact, I think the only industry that they're not involved in is hairdressing. I would like to say, I know that, you know, Asma has been, lots of great tributes have been paid her. And I was a bit sort of taken aback when people said,